fire, your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has thee. No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has
somebody
thee.
Told me Hagins' passion was strong. Yeah, I can see that. Said love for his people was long. Yeah, I can feel that. Cause spitting knowledge, then the village was born. Hold on tight, we spitting fire tonight. Destroying lies, renewing lives like never before. He's teaching truth, withholding nothing, leaving you wanting more. He changed my life, uncovered truth that was written on walls. The hieroglyphs in ancient Egypt telling stories of all. Spent lonely nights teaching the fight while gripping on walls. He stands alone, not fearing nothing as he sits on the throne. Keep teaching knowledge, fearing nothing so that we stand tall. The 10th of giant, mighty hero, stacking this one for all, no doubt.
No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has thee. No need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has thee.
Yo, I'm the type that like the scholars to shine. You've never seen a cat like this. His work is truly divine. This year, a dedication, he will always prevail. He chose his life for brand new ground here in the ATL. In Missouri, he continues to shine. Oh, ancient one, oh, can you hear me? This is Hagins' high time. Hop in the plane, fly through the air, walk in his shoes. Life will never be fair, no doubt.
Keep preaching, teaching, keep teaching, covering truth.
It's me, Omuda Kun, I'm vibing mighty and high. Gave me my name, ancestral time, we seeking truth, no more lies. CJ, I love your vocals, they're so silky and smooth. We complement each other's sound, I see you making your moves.
That's right, CJ Afia with the vocals so smooth. Rocking the mic, wish I was there tonight with Omuda Kun.
That's right, we spit that fire, vibing mighty tonight. We pay great homage to the mighty as we slay on the mic, no doubt.
Don't need to worry about your newfound knowledge for your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has thee. No need to worry about your newfound knowledge.
Oh, okay, okay.
Your brand new life, which means more. Cause Hagins the power, you see that he has thee.
Oh, yeah. Queen J.F.E. and Queen Omuda Kun. Thank you, sisters, so very much. Thank you so much for such a wonderful presentation. I love that. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And I'm going to keep that going. You know what I mean? Well, thank you, brother. And listen, hey, it's time for us to get into our fellowship here online, right? Welcome to another Sunday online in GF Fellowship of the African Village and Cultural Center. I am your teacher, your friend, your brother, Ray Hagins, and I'm glad that you are with me right now. Let's get into our opening with one more time. One more time. God allowed us to come together. One more time. Come on, sing it like you mean it, y'all. Everybody, come on. Here we go. Let me hear it. One more time, one more time. God allowed us to come together. One more time, one more time. One more time, God allowed us to come together. God allowed us to come together. One more time. One more time, one more time, God allowed us to come together. One more time, one more time, one more time, God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah. Praise God's name.
God's name, God allowed us to come together, praise his name, to praise her name, to praise her name. God allowed us to come together, yeah, God allowed us, yeah. Sing our song, just to sing our song. God allowed us to come together, sing our song, to sing our song, to sing our song. Oh, God allowed us to come together, sing our, God allowed us, yeah. Now come on, put those hands together, come on. To clap our hands, to clap our hands. God allowed us to come together, clap our hands, to clap our hands, to clap our hands. Oh, God allowed us to come together. God allowed us, yeah. Everybody say one more time. One more time. God allowed us to come together. One more time. One more time. One more time. Oh, God allowed us. Together we'd be together again today, you know. So I appreciate, you know, the opportunity, man. I'm thankful for the privilege to come together with you once again, you know, and I give all praise to the Almighty for allowing that to happen in our lives. You know, let's get right into the oath to the ancestors at this time. Lift your voice with me as we honor those who have made it possible for us to be where we are right now. Their life, their deeds, their legacy, their sacrifice, their contributions. Yeah, come on, let's honor their memory right now by saying these words. Oh, ancestors, black of a thousand midnights, African ancestors, it is to you that we, your children, give respect and honor. Oh, ancestors, we call upon you and welcome you in this place. African ancestors, let your presence fill this place. O ancestors, who have been purposely excluded from the history books so that the world would not know of your greatness. Our African ancestors, who gave civilization to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave the arts to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave music to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave science to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave mathematics to the world. Yes. Our African ancestors, who gave medicine to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave literature to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave philosophy to the world. Our African ancestors, who gave God consciousness to the world. Oh, ancestors, we thank you for devoting your life to make a future for us, your children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Now stand with us, strengthen us, guide us, teach us, and protect us from the snare of our enemies. Rise up, O African ancestors, and let our enemies be scattered.
and give us the wisdom and the boldness to deal with our oppressors and those who hinder the liberation and empowerment of our people. Rise up, O African ancestors, and live in us. And we will not fail to honor you. We will not fail to respect you. We will not fail to hear you. And we will not betray you.
Ashe, Ebo.
And now, brothers and sisters, we want to take the time to honor just a few of the great Africans who have gone ahead of us. We call forth their great African names and honor them to Pharaohs Narmer, Zoja, Sneferu, Khufu, Khafre, Menkaure, and the great vizier and physician and multi-genius Imhotep. We say, Ashe. To Queen Netokris, Queen Sobek Neferu, Queen Ahotep, Queen Amos Nefertari, Queen King Hatshepsut, Nefertiti, Queen T, and Queen Nefertari II, we say Ashe. To Menkepen Ra Tahuti Maze, known as Thutmosis III, Amenhotep III, Akhenaten, Tutankhamun, Ursama Akra, Setepen Ra, Rametsu Meriamun, Ramses II, Sabaka, Taharqa, Hannibal, and the great African warrior Shaka Zulu, we say Ashe. To all of the kings, queens, priests, and warriors of Nubia, Waset, Ethiopia, Kemet, Kenya, the Congo, Tanzania, Uganda, Central, South, and West Al-Kivu land, we say Ashe. To the more than 600 million Africans whose lives were lost in the European invasions of Africa and in the Middle Passage, we say Ashe. To the more than 300 million who have since lost their lives to racism and hate crimes, we say, Ashe. To Harriet Tubman,
Ashe.
Frederick Douglass,
Ashe.
Mary McLeod Bethune,
Ashe.
Nat Turner,
Ashe.
Fannie Lou Hamer,
Ashe.
Sojourner Truth,
Ashe.
Carter G. Woodson,
Ashe.
Booker T. Washington,
Ashe.
Dr. Charles Drew,
Ashe.
Noble Drew Ali,
Ashe.
Benjamin Banneker,
Ashe.
George Washington Carver,
Ashe.
Bishop Richard Allen,
Ashe.
Bishop Charles Harrison Mason,
Ashe.
Howard Thurman,
Ashe.
Mother Mahalia Jackson,
Ashe.
The Honorable Marcus Messiah Garvey,
Ashe.
Benjamin E. May,
Ashe.
Langston Hughes,
Ashe.
Medgar Evers,
Ashe.
Paul Robeson,
Ashe.
Dr. Martin Luther King,
Ashe.
Malcolm X,
Ashe.
Thurgood Marshall,
Ashe.
Mother Clara Hale,
Ashe.
Adam Clayton Powell,
Ashe.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad,
Ashe.
Dr. Amos Wilson,
Ashe.
Dr. John Henry Clark,
Ashe.
Dr. John G. Jackson,
Ashe.
Dr. Shikanta Diop, Dr. Chancellor Williams,
Ashe.
Dr. George G.M. James, Patrice Lumumba,
Ashe.
Kwame Touré, Kwame Nkrumah, Dr. Khalid Muhammad, Dr. Jacob Carruthers, Dr. Ishaka Musa Badashango, Brother Ray Charles, to our mothers and fathers, our grandmothers and grandfathers, to our great-grandmothers and great-grandfathers, our brothers and sisters, sons and daughters, aunts and uncles, nieces, nephews, cousins, and all those who have gone ahead of us and have made their ancestral transition to their life, deeds, legacy, and contributions, we say,
Ashe.
Again, we say,
Ashe.
Again, we say,
Ashe. God is great and he's worthy to be praised. I say Alleluia. God is great, yes, and he's worthy to be praised. I say Alleluia. God make us one. We all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. God make us one.
We all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. God, make us one.
Yeah.
We all should be one. And then the unbelievers will come and say, you are with us. Yeah.
Woo! Yeah.
Oh, it's such a wonderful thing, family, when we have the opportunity to come together as we are right now. Thank you for being with me today. I trust that wherever you are, you're doing absolutely blacktastic. If you're not doing blacktastic, I hope you're doing blacktacular. And if you're not doing blacktacular, I hope you're doing blacknificent. Welcome, welcome, welcome once again, family, to another fellowship, online fellowship of the African Village and Cultural Center. I am your teacher, your friend, your brother. I'm Ray Hagins, man. I'm glad you're with me today. You could have been anywhere else, but you chose to be right here. And I'm excited about that. You know? Yeah. Well, we're in for another day of learning, fellowshipping together, you know, just having a wonderful time. I trust you've had a wonderful week. You know, I've had a great week. Despite the things that's going on, I've had a great week. You know, I have to give the praise to Almighty, to the Most High, to Almighty God, you know, for allowing us, all of us. When I say us, I mean me and you too. You know, to come together again, even though it's virtually or electronically or by way of the internet, we're all together here on one accord with one purpose, you know, and that's the wonderful thing about this. Yeah, man, just great. I want to take a moment to say thank you to all of you who are our supporters, to our extended family of the African Village, of course, with the brothers and sisters and elders there at headquarters, first of all, is where we began. Then to the African Village of Youngstown, Ohio, to the elders and members there, Model Tep, to our brothers and sisters in Chicago and Detroit areas, Model Tep to you, to the African Village of New York City. Yeah, man, powerful group up there. Model Tep to you guys as well. To the African Village of Charleston, South Carolina. Yeah, we love you guys down there as well. Thank you for the work that you're doing and upholding the standard of the African Village. You know, to all of you everywhere, you know, not just those African villages, but to our supporters, our friends, those who keep us in prayer each week, you know, those who just, you know, give us that energy. When you meditate, you think about us, you know, that kind of thing, you know. Wherever you are, to our friends down in Florida, to our family down in Guyana, South America, listen, I'm going to start missing somebody if I start. Okay, up in Canada, our brothers and sisters down in the Virgin Islands down there, okay? And also our family down in the motherland, or over, I should say, across the pond there in the motherland. It's just good to have all y'all with me right now. And I can actually feel that, be honest with you. I can actually feel the oneness of so many of us all over the place. And it's wonderful. It's just great, man, you know? It's just great. Yeah. I give praise today for, you know what, I'll just say it this way. So people have been asking me, Ray, how you doing? Da, 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 da. I'll say it this way. I have lived to see the goodness of God in my life. That's the best way I can describe it, man. I have lived to see the goodness of the Lord in my life. Yeah. I'm a testimony. I'm a witness, you know, that the Most High is awesome. Yeah. And I'm excited about that right now, you know, and I'm going to spread this message as much as I know how, everywhere I go, for as long as I can, you know, and I'm going to keep on doing, you know why? Because y'all going to help me. Y'all been helping me. Y'all been giving me that strength. Y'all been supporting me with your prayers. Amen. And Brother Ray has been, I'm going to keep on keeping on. That's all it's to it, you know. Oh, goodness. Well, let's get ready for our message today, for our teaching, okay? Let's bring this on the screen here. Of course, that's our brand. What does that say? The space inside this circle represents my realm of knowledge. I start all of my teachings off with this, right? Those of you who've been following me for a while, you know this already. All that I think I know about whatever I think I know is depicted right here within this circle. I must keep in mind that there is more to know than what is within the circumference of my awareness. Yeah, man. Also, brothers and sisters, why do I do this? Why do I teach? Okay, every time I get up to teach, I have to explain this to people because I want them to be clear on what my assignment is. Okay, the reason why Brother Ray Hagins is on this planet is so that I can be an instrument in the hands of the Most High to begin the process of undoing and reversing those ideas and concepts that have been programmed into the minds of our people by the religious statements and church doctrines that have caused us to adopt a belief system that has resulted in our loss of contact with what is real, our loss of contact with what is factual, our loss of contact with what is historical, but most of all, our loss of contact with what is spiritual. Yeah, man. Okay? So that's why we do this, okay? Of course, brothers and sisters, I want y'all to remember this also, especially you religious leaders out there who are coming to the crossroads wondering which way to go. When you've told so many lies on top of each other over the centuries, that telling the truth about one of your early foundational lies would unravel all the lies that have been defensively piled on top of it, thus exposing you for what you truly are, you have no choice but to continue to lie. You see, when your ability to maintain your control over another person's reality is based on the lies about what you are and who they are, you can never tell the truth. Just that simple, okay? So I say to you, as it has been said of old, where Moses supposedly said to Pharaoh, let my people go, I say to you religious pharaohs today, let my people go. Okay, it's time for us to be free now. Free from a whole lot of programming. Yeah, man. Okay. Today, brothers and sisters, I want to talk about this subject right here. Messed up by religion. Oh, my goodness. Messed up by religion. And as we get into this today, I pray that you will be blessed in a mighty way. Okay. I pray that you be blessed by the message today. Sit back, get something right with, get ready to enjoy this today. Okay. And be blessed. All right. Okay. Let's do this now. The subject that I want to share with you today, brothers and sisters, is entitled Messed Up by Religion. Messed up by religion. I came to this subject as a result of the struggle, as our sister announced earlier, for the liberation of the minds of our people. Let me preface this message with an excerpt of my testimony, a little bit of it, so you can see where I am. And I honor those of you who are visiting with us today. Thank you for coming and being with us. Having grown up in the church all my life, and I do mean all my life, I was a church kid, a product of churchianity. Did y'all hear what I just said? A product of churchianity. I became drilled, versed, trained in all of the dogmas of the Christian faith. For those of you who do not know, and I don't say this to boast, but just to let you know, I hold 5 degrees in their program. According to them, I met their qualifications and their standards and passed all their tests and submitted all the papers and modules that I'm supposed to submit. I was trained as a good boy. I was trained to train you and what the oppressor gave to us.
One of the things that I like to share with people is this, in the sense of reasoning. Those who stole us from our motherland, put chains around our necks, raped our women, castrated our men, cut off the feet of those who refused to be a slave so that they couldn't run. They gave us a belief system. Now we'll die to defend the belief system that they who hated us gave us. Something in your mentality ought to say, whatever my enemy gives me is not for my good. But what happened is generations later, being born into the program, being raised into it, we developed a love for what we didn't even understand. They, and when I say they, I mean the powers that be, came up with a word called theology. What is theology? It comes from two words, theos, meaning God, ology, meaning the study of. Look at the person nearest you and say, you cannot study God. Now, for a person to think that they can study God means that they don't understand who and what God is. Let me get even deeper than that, even on that premise. Let me define for you in this kind of a way. Theology is the science which has as its object incomprehensible things.
Yes, sir.
Brother Ray, what do you mean by incomprehensible? I mean you can't comprehend it. Yeah. Now think about it. I want to take my time and just deal with this very slow so that your mind can work with me here today. Because see, growing up in church, I didn't have to use my mind.
Yeah.
Y'all hear what I'm saying? You know, and the presentation of the message was in such a way to it was designed to as I didn't use my mind. You know, because the presentation got into and only thing I had to do in church was say, yes! The presentation was in such a manner that people sang to me instead of taught me. Now I understand that one of the reasons for the sing-song presentation is because of a lack of substantial data. When there's a lack of substantial data, you have to present your message, your viewpoint, your ideas in a way to where the mind won't turn you off. In fact, you have to present it in such a way as where the mind doesn't have anything to do with it at all. And yet at the same time, even though our minds were not a part of the learning process, we were trained, not educated, trained into what's called religion. Theology is the science which has for its object incomprehensible things. Unlike everything else, theology, the study of God, that was, see, and by the way, I want you to understand, that is not something that we did. Theology is not something that comes from African people. Africans knew you don't try to study the Almighty. All right. Africans knew that nobody was qualified to tell you how the Almighty thought. Africans knew millennia ago that nobody is qualified to tell you how the Almighty is going to act or respond to a thing. Who dares know that? But religion makes it so. Unlike everything else, theology occupies itself with things that you can't see. Y'all with me? Notice what I said. It occupies itself with what cannot be seen. It occupies itself with what cannot be verified. It occupies itself with what cannot be substantiated.
Yes, sir. Yes.
In this realm of theology or religion, whether it's Judaism, notice I pronounce it with a Y sound. That's the proper pronunciation. We call it Judaism, but there was no J until the 16th century on this planet. You understand? So the proper pronunciation would be Judaism. If it's Judaism, if it's Christianity, if it's Islam, if it's Buddhism, if it's Zoroastrianism, if it's Hinduism, whatever it is, if it's Quetzalcoatlism, if it's Zoroastrianism, I'm naming all of the religions here, okay? See, a lot of people, look at the person next to you and say, if you only know one, you know none. You don't even have a right to speak if you don't know the others. And then that which we think we know was programmed into us when we were 2.5 years old. When we didn't, before we were even old enough to understand the propriety of the matter. When it comes to theology, when it comes to religion, guess what I found out, y'all? Light is darkness. Okay? When I say light, I mean, what is symbolic of light? Truth. And darkness is error, right? But in theology, light is darkness. And those who find truth, that's what folk tell you. They tell you walking in darkness.
Right.
You done lost your mind.
Right.
You done got into a cult.
Yes.
What's a cult about a pyramid?
Right.
Here's this big, massive pyramid in Egypt that's been there over 7,000 years. That ain't a cult. That's a fact. Now, why is that so? So what about a pyramid that's been there over 7,000 years, Pastor? What about that? What about the Sphinx that's been there over 18,000 years? That's not a cult. That's a fact. And that fact puts a monkey wrench in religion.
That's right.
Follow what I'm saying, people, because religion says that a guy named Adam was the first person here. But if Adam was sitting in this room right now, the oldest he would be about 6,700, 800 years old. The Sphinx is over 18,000 years old. So what's the name of the guy who built that? That's a fact. When we come to religion, that which is true is treated as it's a lie. Evidence that you can't deny, like Harmacket, like the pyramids of ancient Africa, evidence that you can touch with your hand becomes doubtful or false. Or those who've never been there will tell you, you don't know what you're talking about. It's like the brother said to me a few months ago, there ain't no pyramids over there. I just turned and walked away from him. That's a myth they made up. That's what he said. In religion,
The impossible, becomes the credible in religion. Reason, how to use your mind, how to use your thinking capacity in religion becomes an undependable guide. And you know what they tell us? They tell us, now you know, lean not into your own understanding. Ain't that what we were taught? What else am I going to lean on? Whatever you say to me, I don't care if it's foolish or reality, whatever you say to me, I'm still going to have to understand it. Some kind of way to make it applicable to my life. So when you turn around and tell me, don't lean on my own understanding, then that means what? The rest of the verse goes on to say, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct thy paths. Well, I have to be honest with you. Africans have done that for millennia. We stopped doing that within the last 2,000 years. We stopped leaning on the Almighty to direct our path because we started leaning on doctrine. Y'all okay? We stop leaning on the Almighty. We start leaning on church tradition. We stop leaning on the Almighty to guide us. We started leaning on the opinion of the saints. What the saints gonna say? Am I making sense, people? Common sense. What's just downright common sense? To those people who are religious people, they call it delirious. Well, this is all summed up in what is called theology. I want to drop this on you. Repeat this after me. God's people, were not born, religious. God's people were not born religious. In fact, brothers and sisters, God's people are not religious. God's people are spiritual. Big difference. Big difference between religion and spirituality. Religion is a set of doctrines, codes, standards, and rules that other human beings sat down and decided should be. And I don't mind telling you this, it wasn't black human beings either. All of the dogmas and doctrines that we grew up with, brothers and sisters, were compiled in what's called ecumenical council meetings of the Roman Catholic Church. Don't take my word for it. Read for yourself the Council of Nicaea. Read for yourself the Council of Ephesus. Read for yourself the Council of Chalcedon. Read for yourself the Council of Constantinople. Read for yourself the Council of Trent. And you'll see how the Roman Catholic Church sat down and said, this is what's going to be. And anybody who does not abide by what we have decreed, let them be anathema. Anathema means accursed. Who gave these people the right to determine what spirituality is? We've been messed up by religion. All religious principles are founded on the idea of a God. And I'm getting ready to drop some stuff on y'all now. Okay, so hold on to your waistline and your belt, and you know. Dig in. I'm getting ready to drop some stuff on you here. All religious principles are founded on the idea of a God. But it is impossible for people to have a true idea of a being that they cannot comprehend.
Think with me.
Yes, sir.
How are you going to have a foundation on an idea of a being that you can't comprehend? Right. If you can't comprehend this being, how are you ever going to get anywhere? So I was taught, well, his ways are past finding out. I'm trying to see, do the facial and everything, you know. God works. What's the rest of the line? I see y'all was taught the same thing. Isn't it deep, brothers and sisters? No religious system can be founded otherwise than upon the nature of God and man and their relationship to each other. Now follow this out well. How am I going to have a relationship with somebody if I can't comprehend them?
All right.
Okay. Y'all with me? Think with me, black folk. You're supposed to have a personal relationship with somebody that you can't understand. I see the light bulb starting to come on now. And it's deep because in order to judge the reality of your relationship, you must have some idea of the divine nature of the person you got the relationship with. But theology tells us that the essence of God is incomprehensible. Yet at the same time, our religious teachers do not hesitate to assign attributes to this incomprehensible God. Now, if God is incomprehensible, then how can you assign attributes to him? Am I making sense, y'all? Can we use our thinking faculties today? And then what's really deep is the religious promoters assign attributes to this incomprehensible God and then convince us that we cannot dispense without a knowledge of God who is impossible to conceive.
Come on,
I don't know if y'all followed that one. You can't live without a knowledge of God. Right? But yet God is incomprehensible. He's impossible, or she's impossible to conceive. So then how you gonna get anywhere? Look at the person next to you and say, you don't really. Reasons why we have too many people who cannot tell you why they believe what they believe. And then the other thing that's deep about it, well, I don't want to rush ahead of myself. I'll break it down. Let me ask this question to you. And I really want y'all to think with me this morning, okay? Leave your emotions out of this for a moment and think for a moment. Just think. It's not a sin to think, y'all.
That's right.
I need to say that again. It's not a sin to think. Why is it that the most important thing for man is that which is impossible for him to comprehend? Did that make sense to you? The most important thing in your life, you can't comprehend it. Important power in your life, you don't understand it. The most important power in your life, you can't conceive it. But yet it's the most important thing to you. If God is incomprehensible to us, then why does religion conclude
that we are a criminal when it comes to faith? Why does religion say that we are criminal? If you cease for one moment to revere God. Oh, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. You have folks, tell me something. Do you believe in God? How many of y'all have been asked that question? Do y'all not know that those kind of questions did not happen until the Europeans invaded Africa? Africans never asked a question like that. That's one of the dumbest questions there is. Because see, when people ask that question, they don't really mean, do you believe in God? What they mean is, do you believe what I believe? That's what people mean when they ask that question. And if your answer does not satisfy their paradigm, then they feel it's their duty to straighten you out. Am I making sense, y'all? You see, religion assures us that our limited minds should never lose sight of the inconceivable God, whose qualities we can't comprehend. Oh, that's so deep. That's enough to give you a headache, you know that? I mean, that's enough to give you a migraine. Everybody repeat after me. Religion is the art of occupying limited minds with that which is impossible for them to comprehend. Occupying our limited minds with what our minds can't comprehend. How is it that we have succeeded in persuading reasonable thinking beings that the thing most impossible to understand is the most essential thing for them? Am I making sense, y'all? See, I hope I'm making sense, because I was typing this in the airport this morning. And of course, all the noise and everything going on, but that, you know, it's just, listen, it is because we were frightened. I'll tell you how we got there, how they got us there. All you got to do is scare people. Yeah. Put fear in them. Make them afraid. Yeah. It is because we were frightened. It is because when people are kept in fear, they cease to think. Oh, shucks, man. It is because we've been trained to distrust the very thing that the Creator put in us to think. God, listen, y'all, God designed your brain to think. God designed your brain to receive things systematically. Now, the best proof of that is our children. Our 2-year-olds, our 3-year-olds, our 4-year-olds, before they get messed up with religion, they do what God made them to do. Their brain goes to work, and you never heard so many, "Mommy, why?" Parents get tired of their children saying, "But Mommy, why? Mommy, why is this? Mommy, why is that? Daddy, why is this?" It's like the brother who came in here, brother used to go here, his little son went outside and looked up in the sky and came back and asked his father, "Why is the sun round?" Little 3-year-old kid, "Why is the sun round?" He ran back in here and said, "Pastor, help me out." Like I could answer the question. But I was impressed with the fact that this 3-year-old black child looked out into the cosmos and saw something and tapped into it and asked about it. Why? Why this? Why that? Why this? Why that? Why this? Now, who do you think made our minds to do that? The Almighty did. That's how God designed your mind to think. And even in something called theology, they have an aspect of it, and those who've been to school can bear witness to what I'm saying. It's called systematic theology. The reason why it's called systematic theology is because they present it in a system. And the reason why they present it in a system is because God designed your brain to work systematically. If it doesn't make sense to your brain is going to keep saying, why, but why? That's not a sin. God made your brain to work like that. But then we reach religion, and religion says, don't ask why. Religion says, just believe it. It don't have to make sense to you. Believe it, because hey, without faith, it's impossible. Ain't that what we've been taught? To please God. God did not say that. The religious controllers said that. Can I drop something on y'all? The book that we carry called the Bible, God did not write one word in it. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? People wrote that. In fact, when you go to the King James Version, you're talking about the result of a whole lot of people after a whole lot of people after a whole lot of people after a whole lot of people wrote that. King James is the one who put into the Bible, honor the king. God didn't say that. James Stewart said that. Before the King James Version of the Bible, that phrase, honor the king, was not in the Geneva Bible, which predated the King James Bible.
That's right.
Don't take my word for it. Go verify what I'm saying. We've been messed up by religion. Is it that we've gotten to this point? Because they scared us. Told you was on your way to hell. Y'all remember the test? Y'all remember the Panare New Testament? No, I'm not. You can't remember it. You didn't read it. But remember the message I talked about? I think that was the message, Christianity and World Conquest. Here you have Christian missionaries who are trying to evangelize the Panare Indians of South America. But see, this deep here, now show you how this goes. In the Panare's culture, there was no word equivalent to the English word sin. There was no word equivalent to the English word hell or damnation. Okay? So therefore, the missionaries were not successful in Christianizing the Panare Indians. So what did they do? They said, we got to come up with a way to scare these people. We got to come up with a way to convince them that they are on their way to hell. Yeah. So the European Christian missionaries came out with a version of the New Testament called the Panare version. Don't take my word for it. Go to the internet and type, let me spell it for you. P-A-N-A-R-E. Panare Indians. That's all you got to go. Go type it in on the internet and they'll come up and show you where they actually came up with a Bible that said the Panare killed Jesus. It went on to say, They laid him on the ground and drove nails in his hands, and the man screamed and cried, and he died like that. The Panare killed Jesus because they are an evil people. Look at the person next to me saying, now that's deep. Religion. Religion is designed to control you. Not help you grow.
That's right.
Religion is not designed to teach you how to think. Religion is to tell you what to think. I repeat, religion is not designed to teach you how to think. Religion is designed to tell you what to think. And as long as they tell you what to think, look at the person next to you and say, you're going to always be a slave. You'll never experience liberation as long as you only think what they want you to think. Brothers and sisters, when the brain is troubled, we believe everything and examine nothing. I repeat, when the brain is troubled, now I'm speaking now from as a psychologist, that's one of the first things we're taught. When the brain is troubled, we believe everything, anything, and don't examine anything.
Yes, sir.
Ignorance. Everybody say ignorance.
Ignorance.
Fear. Say fear.
Fear.
Those two things that I just told you to say. Ignorance and fear are the two pillars of religion. The uncertainty pertaining to man's relationship with his God. Man, this is some deep stuff.
Come on.
I don't want y'all to miss what I'm getting ready to say right now. I'm going to say it slow. Listen carefully, brothers and sisters. Listen carefully. The uncertainty. Okay? That pertains to man's relationship to his God is the very thing that attaches him to his God.
Come on, Doc. Come on, man. Come on, Doc. Yes, sir.
I'll say it one more time, brother. Yeah. The uncertainty that pertains to man's relationship to his God. It is that same uncertainty that attaches him to this God.
Yes, it is. Yes, sir.
Y'all grabbing this?
Yes, sir.
For example, you have no idea how much, you know, even as a child, I used to kind of wonder about it, but as I got older, I stopped challenging it. I used to hear folk testify and say, child, I hope I make it in. That's a statement of uncertainty. Am I making sense? Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100. What's the rest of it, y'all? You got it, because 99 and a half won't do. I'm trying to make 100. That's a statement of uncertainty. I'm coming up on the rough side of the mountain. And what was the end of that phrase? I'm doing my best to make it in. That's a statement of uncertainty. I've never seen so many people uncertain about their relationship with God. How many times have you seen people crying, Oh, God, I'm so sorry, Lord. Why are you crying like that? If you know everything's cool between you and God, why are you freaking out like that? You do something that's not pleasing to God, God, I'm sorry. And move on. But when you got to start bugging out, I don't want to be lost. I don't want to be lost. That's a statement of uncertainty. And yet with that same uncertainty, that's what makes our folk attach themselves to the soul, the very thing that they are uncertain of.
Yeah.
Messed up
yes, sir.
By
religion. Everybody say this. Man needs fear.
Yes, sir.
Now I'm telling you this, I'm getting ready to spill some secrets here.
Come on, man.
I'm getting ready to drop on you. Getting ready to drop on you what social scientists use to control the masses. CIA agents. And their whole job in the Central Intelligence Agency is to strategize control mechanisms over the population. One of their statements is, man needs fear. Why does man need fear? Because he would think that there's something wrong with him if he had nothing to fear.
Come on with
it. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Every control program that's out here has success in their control mechanism through the element of fear. Let me give you an example that all of us can relate to very well. Tithes. Our money when it comes to church work. When folk thought they were going to hell, if they didn't give like they were told to give, as long as they thought they were going to hell, as long as they thought that God was going, you, how does it read? You are cursed with a curse. Who got the Bible here? Oh, I don't want to make it up. Who got the Bible handy? Malachi 3rd chapter. Come on, right quick. Malachi 3rd chapter. Some of y'all know about heart. Malachi 3rd chapter, verse 8. Will a man rob God? Who got the Bible? Who can read that for me right quick? Who's got the Bible reading it? Malachi, last book of the Old Testament. 3rd chapter, 8th verse. Go ahead, Elder.
Will a man rob God?
Yet you have robbed me.
But he
say, well, now let me break it down as you read it. Let me break it down as you read it. Because see, you know, I had this discussion just last night, yesterday afternoon in my workshop. You know, one of the attendees of the workshop had a question, and it was about this. You know, and I said, sister, you got to be delivered from the fear mechanism. Don't give your money because you're afraid. Give your money because you want to give it. She said, well, the Bible says I'm cursed with a curse. I said, no, the Bible don't say no such thing. Yes, it do too. Now, Dr. Hagin, you wrong on that. Because the Bible says I'm cursed with a curse. I said, honey, you wasn't even here when that was written. It wasn't written to you. I mean, come on, y'all. When you write a letter, you write it, you address it to somebody. Why would I get bent out of shape about something that's addressed to Mom Phillips? Then written 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 years ago. Of course, that wasn't what we think it was. Now, let's break it down. Show you what I'm talking about. Read it, Elder. Will a man rob God?
Will a man rob God?
Uh-huh.
Yet
you've robbed me. How?
But he say, wherein?
Wherein have I robbed you, God? Or how have I robbed you, God? What does it say?
In tithes and
offerings. Now, how many of y'all have ever heard this before? Come on, raise your, be honest. You've heard it, right? Good. Okay. Read on, Elder.
You are cursed with a curse.
You are cursed with a curse. Last thing black folk want to hear is I'm cursed. Don't tell a black person they curse, whatever you do. You are cursed with a curse. Go ahead, what is that? Because you've robbed me. In fact, you've robbed this whole nation. Now think, people, think. I said, think with me today. Use your thinking faculty. If the nation got robbed, then who is this talking to?
Come on.
All right.
It's not talking to the people.
Yes,
sir. Who is it talking to them, Brother Ray? Go to the second chapter, Elder. The second chapter, Malachi, first verse. Yes.
And now, O ye priests.
And now, O ye priests.
Yes.
What does it say?
This commandment
is for you.
Yes.
Thank you, Elder. Malachi 2:1 says, you preachers, what I'm about to say now is for you. And from Malachi 2:1 through the rest of the book of Malachi, it's a rebuke to the preachers who were misusing the money that the people had brought. I take that back. It wasn't money. It was goods. It was crops. It was their possessions. Y'all follow what I'm saying? So it is, as I tell you, like I told us yesterday, it is inappropriate. In fact, it's just scripturally criminal. For somebody today to use Malachi 3:8 to teach tithing. Because it's not a verse to teach tithing. It's a rebuke for the religious leaders who was misusing the tithes.
Yes.
That's why I said, you have robbed me. You've not only robbed me, you robbed the people.
Yeah.
That's the truth.
Priests. Now, I'm sorry I taught some people that. I gotta be honest with you. Because once you found out that wasn't talking to you, well, man, shoot, I'm glad you told me that. Man. Who? Man, because I need this $25. Ain't that deep? When the brain is troubled, we believe everything and examine nothing. If religion was clear instead of ambiguous, and ambiguous means uncertain, not clear. If religion was clear instead of ambiguous, it would not be as attractive to the masses. You know why this room is not filled? And it's really deep because I've been here how many years now?
6 years.
Y'all heard me say on the radio, I put out all over the internet, somebody invalidate one thing I've said. This brother even here testified today when he stood up. He said, the things that the brother said, I went and checked it out and found out he was right. This brother here, is y'all here over there? I'm like, yes, sir. Yeah. That brother right there, that still got that Baptist draw in him. You know, that brother right there. He got here and told y'all his whole purpose for coming here was to get me.
Yes, sir. Yes.
He came to invalidate what I had to say.
Yes, sir.
And in the process, got hooked by the truth himself.
Yes, sir.
Problem is, we take the fear out of it.
Yes, sir. That's right.
You don't have to be afraid over here.
That's right.
You don't have to be afraid of God.
Yeah.
In fact, we make stuff too factual.
Yeah.
And people don't like that.
No,
people want to believe in what they can't comprehend.
Yes,
people want to commit themselves and devote themselves and give their lives for what they don't even understand.
Yes, that's right.
I don't understand that. Now that's deep to me.
Yeah.
I take that back. I used to be there too.
Yeah,
I used to be there too. I sure was.
Yes, sir.
I sure was. You see, brothers and sisters, and I speak from experience. I was there. You were there. Some of you are still there. The ignorant, and when I say that, don't be offended. I don't confuse ignorant with stupid. Ignorant simply means you don't know. Everybody say, I may know what I know. About what I know. But that doesn't mean that I know all there is to know about what I know. Don't ever forget that. The ignorant need obscurity. The ignorant, those who don't know any better, they need mysteries. They need fables. They need incredible things to keep their brains perpetually at work and uncertain. That gives them a sense of accomplishment when reality ain't accomplished nothing because they don't even understand what's going on. But they think they're getting somewhere. Because, woo, child, woo. Y'all know it's true. It amazes me how sometimes people get up and they get to talking about God and they just have to do something else. Because there's nothing to make sense. So because there's nothing to make sense, they have to do, hey! And that's supposed to give validity.
Yeah.
Y'all see what I'm saying? See, now to young people, children observing this, and young people say, oh, wow, man. Ooh, whoa. Whoa. Ooh, man. As far as it goes. But to make a systematic, sensible, factual, evidence presentation of fact and truth, that ain't mystifying enough for us. I want a God of miracles. I want a God that can send me a check in the mail from nobody. Then you know you serving God. I mean, that's what we want. That's what we want. Man, we get turned on by stuff like that. Woo, child, my car wouldn't start. Hey, glory. And I said, Jesus. And it started right up. We want that. That's what we want. Y'all know I'm telling the truth. As long as it's got some mysticism or some mystery to it, woo, we turned on by that. And we'll give our money to that. Yes, we will. We'll give $500 to a promise that don't make no sense. You want that miracle? Didn't even say what it was. You want that miracle? Plant a seed offering of $500. All right. What miracle?
Right.
And then you know how to cover it up? Well, somebody may come back and say, well, I gave the $500, I ain't get my miracle. What you mean you ain't get your miracle? You woke up this morning, didn't you? Yeah, buddy. Woo, he's so gullible, I'm telling you. Now, let me. When it comes to religion, y'all, most people are just overgrown children. The more absurd a religion is, the more power it has. In fact, there would never be anything called religion if there had been no dark ages.
Right.
Now follow what I'm saying. I don't know where I'm at. Okay, I'm good. You see, around the 4th century, 325 AD, when the Roman Catholic Church created this program that we now call Christianity at the Council of Nicaea, under the rule of Emperor Constantine with 318 Roman Catholic bishops. Fact. Thereafter, shortly thereafter, the program wasn't catching hold
in the minds of the people fast enough. So the Roman Catholic Church thrust the Roman Empire, or the then known world as we were taught to call it, into what was called the Dark Ages. Now mind you, this is in the 4th century, the Nicene Council, 325 AD. At starting 500 AD, the Roman Catholic Church suppressed information. All books were burned. I repeat, all books were burned. Anybody who was caught with any sacred writings of the ancient African spiritual system was put to death. I repeat, anybody who was caught with any of the writings from ancient Africa was put to death by order of the Roman Emperor. So from 500 AD to 1500 AD, information and right knowledge was suppressed. Fact. They call it the Dark Ages, or that was the period of medieval Europe, or the Middle Ages. All these names, the same thing. Well, after 1,000 years of suppressing right knowledge, well, what do you think these folk were doing during that 1,000 years? They was reforming it, interpolating it, adjusting it, twisting it, erasing it, replacing it for 1,000 years. And in 1500, they came out and it was called the Age of the Renaissance, meaning a new thing is happening.
Yes.
Well, what do you think they're teaching everybody now? What they created during that 1,000 year period. Just before that, or shortly thereafter, somewhere around that same time period, this dude named Gutenberg came out with what's called the printing press. And if you want to control the thinking of a people, all you got to do is put it in print. The power of the printed page. Shortly after that, James Stewart decided he wanted his version of the Bible out. So he got 40 so-called scholars to come together and put his version of the Bible out, and to this day, from 1611 or 1600s to this day, it is still the number one seller on this planet.
Yes, sir.
All religion. Everybody repeat this after me. All religion
was born
from a desire
to
dominate and control others
for profit and power.
This is why we Africans must return to our African spirituality. That's what the African village is about. That's what this ministry is about.
Yes, sir.
Brothers and sisters, I take no joy. Yes. I take no joy in pointing out to our people the lie that was given to us. Because I know it's unbearable for many. It hurts for many. And they resist it. They retaliate. They say, this man is crazy. He's an antichrist. I take no joy in that. I want to be patted on the back. I don't want to be talked about.
Right.
But I got to tell you the truth. I got to tell you the truth. The only way that I'm going to set our people free is if I show our people the lie that has mind cuffed them. People don't like it when you tell them that they've been believing a lie. I didn't like it. My mama, my mother, the woman who raised me, who's responsible for
speak to me for 2 years. Yeah. That's how deep this thing is. Until she started slowly but surely reading little bit for herself. She still ain't ready to grab it all, but y'all heard her when she was here. Keep on doing what you're doing, son. We Africans must return back to the God consciousness that we had before we were stolen from our motherland and given a belief system from a people who don't look like us, who don't want us to know the truth. I promise you this. When we do that,
yes, sir,
the healing that we're praying for will take place. When we return to our story and stop believing his story. When we return to who we are, a right knowledge of self and our spirituality, I guarantee you our homes will be better off. We've been messed up by religion. And I promise God that every breath I have left in my body from this day to the day I die, I'm going to use it to unmess us up. It's the truth. That's what this ministry is about. I watched a movie called The Warriors, and this brother stood up in the Warriors and said, "Can you dig it?"
Yes, sir. That's right.
I'm asking you that now. Can you dig what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
If you can, then commit your life to the resurrection, liberation, and empowerment of our people, of our children, that our people will get right knowledge. And not the indoctrinations from a people who want to enslave us and keep us oppressed. Ashe.
Oh my goodness. Messed up by religion. Are you free today? If not, hey, free your African mind. All right, live in the power of who you are. But you got to know yourself first. You know, I hope you got something out of that message today, brothers and sisters. Yeah, man, it's been good. Just what can I tell you? Are you dining like I am? Even though it's a message I did a long time ago, I'm still getting fed from it. And I hope you are too. Let's get ready to get out of here. But before doing that, all right, if you're listening, watching on YouTube, please go ahead and hit that subscribe button. All right, and the notification bell as well, so that when I do go live, you'll get a notice of it. All right, and if you see here my email address, rayhagins@gmail.com. Okay, if you want to write me a question or send me a question, better yet, go to the website, okay, theafricanvillage.org. Okay, it's up and running now. Go to our website, theafricanvillage.org, and you'll see across the top there, Q&A for Dr. Ray. If you have any questions you want to ask, all right, go on and send me a question. And I'll get back to you on it. If you are not a member of our virtual family, go ahead and join right there on the website, okay? Become a member. Yeah, man, and you'll be a part of us. This way you get everything that we get given out, all communications, all of the notices, you know, announcements, whatever. You'll be abreast of it all, you know? Yeah, it's time for us to keep on moving, keep on trucking. I'm so excited about what the Most High is doing through us, okay? I also invite you to log on and listen to our 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week teaching, webcasting. And then you find that there on the website as well, okay? You at the tab there, you'll see where it says, I believe it says Black Liberation Radio, all right? You click that tab at the top there, and you'll see two things there. The first thing you'll see is the 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week broadcast. Click that, and you'll hear me teaching, okay, nonstop, yeah. Nonstop. And then the one below that is actually our TV channel, Black Lib TV. So if I want to go live on television without having to worry about YouTube or Facebook saying you're violating community standards,
we'll broadcast right there. Okay? Yeah. It's good to have your own. You know, mama may have, papa may have, but God bless the child that has his own. You understand? Yeah, buddy. Oh, my goodness. Also, family, if you're making donations to support us with the work we're doing, you see there how to do it, right? Go to paypal.com, okay? And our PayPal address is africanvillage1@aol.com. Or if you're right there on the website, you'll see a donate button, okay? Click that. And then you can go there to take you to our PayPal page, and you can choose the amount that you would like to donate. Just put in there if you want to donate $5, $10, $100, $500, $1,000, whatever you want to donate, it would be certainly appreciated by us, all right? If you're donating through Cash App, our address is #Tag Dr. Ray Hagins. If you're donating through Zelle, it's the email address, rayhagins@gmail.com. If you're mailing in your donation, you see the address there. The African Village, make your check or money order payable to the African Village and mail it to 863 Flatshoals Road, Southeast, Suite number 242, Conyers, Georgia, 30094. Okay? Yeah, man. Family, I thank you guys so very much for simply being who you are and how you continue to support our work. And, of course, I don't want to leave without mentioning this group right here. The Black Achievement Fund, man. You know, yeah. Okay. Come on and be a part of our experience. We're having a wonderful time together doing some great things in the Black Achievement Fund. So come on and be with us. All right. The Most High is doing some great things, and we got some beautiful people. And it's nothing like doing stuff with your own people. You know, when you see your other brothers and sisters coming together and empowering themselves economically. Okay, that inspires others to do as well, you know. So come on, man, we're doing some great things in the Black Achievement Fund, and we invite you to come be a part of it. Okay, and you see that little brother right there with his arm raised up? That's our national president and founder of the Black Achievement Fund, Brother R. Key Hodges, the man with the vision. Okay, I'm saying that seriously, because when I heard his presentation, I said, "Yep, I want to be a part of this." And I want you to be a part of it too. So come on and join us at the Black Achievement Fund. You see the address there at the bottom of the page, BAF.solutions. That's Black Achievement Fund, okay? BAF.solutions. Go there. Sign up to become a member. It's only $9 a month. That's all, man. $9 a month, okay? Can you see that in your mind? Can you see that 10 million people giving $9 a month? That will give us over $1 billion a year. As an entity, to have a platform to operate from, so we don't have to ask folks to give us nothing. That's where we ought to be anyway. Got me? Okay, so come on and be a part of us. Listen, coming up at the 2 o'clock hour on Eastern time, anyway. Go to BAF.solutions and listen to Brother Arkey's presentation. And then come on and be a member of the Black Achievement Fund, all right? And listen, when you join. It's gonna ask in the application, how did you hear about us? Okay, and if you heard about them through me or the African Village, put that there, because they're gonna send me an email telling me that you joined. Then I'm gonna send you one from me saying welcome to the Black Achievement Fund. Brothers and sisters, I have had such a wonderful time being with you today, as always, man. It's just a great thing, you know. I'm excited about all that the Most High is doing through us and in us and with us, you know. So, yeah, come on and be a part of what we're doing. You know, the virtual village is growing exponentially. It's growing everywhere, you know. Spread the word. That's how we grow. You know, just spread the word. Just copy the link, okay, to the video or to the teaching, and email it out to somebody. Okay? Pledge to mail it out to at least 5 to 10 people a week. Just, you don't have to say nothing, just send it. That's how we get the word out, you know? Okay? Well, it's time for us to get ready to get out of here now. And of course, you know, to do that, we got to sing our song, "The African in Me Loves the African in You." And when we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You know why? Because you're easy to love. So come on and let's sing this now as we get ready to get out of here. Yeah. Here we go. Oh, yeah. Come on, everybody. The African in me loves the African in you.
African in me, love the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're easy. You are so easy. To love. Listen again, the African in me, love the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. African in me, love the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're easy. Yeah, family, you're easy to love. Principles of our truth, the truth that's in me, love the truth that's in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Truth that's in me, love the truth that's in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You're easy to love. Justice, come on, everybody. The justice in me, love the justice in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Justice in me, love the justice in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. You're easy. You are so easy. Oh, you're so easy. Yeah, 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 yeah. Easy to love. Righteousness, come on. Righteousness in me, love the righteousness in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Yeah, the righteousness in me, love the righteousness in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Cause you're easy. You're easy. You are so easy. Yeah, yeah. You're easy to love. Let's close out. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. The African in me loves the African in you. When we come together, ain't nothing we can't do. Cause you're easy. You are so easy. Ooh, you're easy. You're easy to love. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You're so easy to love. You're so easy to love. Yeah, man, I'm telling you. You're easy to love, African family. And I thank the Most High for each of you and for how you're with me every week. Listen, guys, as you go throughout your coming week, okay, be careful. Take care of yourself. Most of all, okay, keep your head up. Keep your head up. I'm going to share a line with you for those of you who may have felt somewhat discouraged or whatever. Came to me a little over a week ago. I'm sharing it with you now. And that is this. Don't throw in the towel. It's too soon to quit. Somebody needed that word right there. Okay, guys, you take care out there, okay? And I'll see you guys on next week. All right, stay strong. I'm Mur, all of you. Peace.